often and focuses on a global perspective. So often we get tied up into local issues, which are really important, but you know, if we don't tackle the global issue, then any successes we have on a local, regional, or state, or country, national level, aren't going to mean anything. So, and the authors, Roni Partanen and Jana Kohonen, they're from Finland. And I actually had the pleasure of meeting Rauli last year from Chicago at a world nuclear event. And that's where I got all the extra copies. So it was nice to give them to me. But these guys are not associated with the nuclear industry. They're completely financially independent. They're not wealthy. Jana is an engineer. Rauli is an energy researcher. And they put a lot of effort into, you know, really objectively, you know, researching these issues. So that's kind of how I came about this book. But also, I'm not going to do a blow-by-blow, you know, book review. What I want to do is just kind of give some introductory remarks and some high-level remarks to kind of frame our discussion. And then I'll also provide some background information that will be helpful to kind of help understand some of the topics. And then we'll just turn it loose and just have a good discussion. So in the introduction to the book, it was written by Dave McKay, who was a professor of engineering at Cambridge, and he was also a scientific energy advisor for the UK. And he also wrote the book Sustainable Energy Without the Hot Air. So he is a globally recognized expert. He's an educator. He's just, you know, really trusts this man. So he wrote the introduction, and I just want to go over some of that. What he says is that we have, in terms of climate change, we have levers, British, levers, levers. And I think about it as a machine with actual levers. You know, this is what we can do if we're trying to stop climate change. We have the ability to move these levers up and down. You know, we can do more hydro, we can do more wind, we can do bioenergy, we can eat less meat. I mean, we can say, well, we need to, you know, remove 6 billion people from the planet. That might be a hard sell. But nevertheless, you know, that's, if you want to just think about it objectively, we have certain things we can do if we're trying to get to what's the best way to prevent or minimize climate change. So these are various levers. And he goes on to say that each one of those items has its own technical limits and political difficulties. And that's where the real world comes in. It gets sticky. And if we're really doing a good job nationally, globally, and even locally, we would do well to try to objectively look at the technical limits and the political difficulties of all those different options and try to find that sweet spot where when we move those levers as best we can, it's going to deliver us to, you know, the most effective climate mitigation track or pathway and get us there the quickest. So that's kind of an overview of, you know, that's where they're coming from in this book. And then McKay goes on to say at the end of his introduction, don't leap to simplistic conclusions. We owe it to our children to behave like adults. Have an open mind, read, learn, think, and discuss. And I just can't think of a better way to, you know, frame this discussion. So this is definitely a heavy lift for humanity. And If we put any stock at all in the IPCC, the international group of scientists has looked at the climate situation. What they're basically saying is that we have to decarbonize all energy sectors by 2050. This is for the entire world.
Are they talking about decarbonization?
No, I said essentially. What they actually say is if we want to hold to the 2 degree centigrade maximum increase in global temperature, they're calling for a minimum 80% reduction in 1990 emission levels by 2050. So that's why I say, essentially, we need to try to decarbonize everything. You know, and that's just to keep things from being catastrophic. It's still going to be bad. If we decarbonized, if the entire world stopped emissions completely today, the effects of climate change will continue to get worse for decades because the greenhouse gases are in the atmosphere, the heat is stored in the ocean, and this is not going to be easy. And if we do everything right, it's still going to be a different world 35 years from now than it is today. So that's what we need to keep in mind. Also, this is time sensitive. You know, in terms of trying to assess, well, do we need nuclear? Should we do away with it? You know, what about? We have one shot. And we can't afford to go 15 or 20 years down a pathway and decide, well, you know, that didn't work too well. Sorry. You know, it takes about 40 to 50 years, typically from in our industrial society, to change our energy infrastructure, to make a major change. It doesn't happen overnight. So it was a while to really, you know, step back and consider carefully. And then again, as I mentioned earlier, climate mitigation is a first order problem. If we don't get this handled, then all the other ones, the social issues, the equality, all those things are important. Recycling, efficiency, you know, we at Omni, those issues mean a lot to us. But in terms of perspective, if we don't get this one solved, then all those things are just, you know, they're insignificant.
You mean the decarbonization?
Yes.
Aspect.
Yes. And the climate change. Right. So some of the goals in the book, Climate Gamble, they sort of review some of the common pro and con nuclear arguments. And some of their discussion viewpoints, they spend a fair amount of time talking about some of the limitations of renewables. And by renewables, that's a term I don't like, but because it's arbitrary. By renewables, they mean basically wind, solar, geothermal, those are the main ones.
Hydro?
Pardon?
Hydro?
Yeah, and hydro, yes.
Is it?
Absolutely. So they talk about the limitations of renewables and some of the misinformation about nuclear. So we can, you know, go into some of that today too. And the book really tries to compare the strengths and weaknesses of solutions in a level-headed, evidence-based manner. And that's just not something you see a lot of in media. Things get so partisan and ideological. So that's one thing I appreciate about the book. Another thing, and this comes up often, is that, you know, nuclear, it's dangerous. Boom, toxic, dangerous, explosion, nuclear war. And risk assessment is something that people are inherently not very good at. And often these arguments that label nuclear as dangerous, they rely on a biased perception of risk where just the possibility of some harm in the far future, it's given far more weight than the near certainty of large harm costs today or in the near future. And so that comes back to what I was saying about, you know, the climate mitigation and decarbonization is a first order problem. You know, if we don't do that well, there will be major, major disruptions in global population, biosphere viability, and we need to keep that in mind. Nuclear, could something happen? Yes, there's a non-zero chance of something negative happening to anything humanity does. You know, we just have to accept that. But we have to be careful not to give some of these remote risks undue weight, because, you know, if we've left out a valuable part of the solution, we might not do the best job we possibly can. And we know there's going to be large harm if we don't. For me, I think about this as in triage terms. You know, the Earth's biosphere, humanity, it's a patient on the operating table in a tent in the field. You know, there's been massive trauma, hemorrhaging, and we have to do something right now to save this patient. All we've got are the tools that are on the shelf, and, you know, we need to make a good decision right now and do it. and that's where we are. You know, so we might choose some things that are going to have some side effects down the road. Okay, how do they compare to, you know, if we didn't use every option at our disposal? The consequences are much greater. So that's the risk assessment part, keep that in mind. Another thing that, and I've experienced this personally, and they talk about it in the book, is arguing against evidence. And it turns out that anti-nuclear environmentalists and climate denialists, it's the same behavior pattern. And actually, I consider myself a pro-nuclear environmentalist. And there's a pretty large community of people that would give the same label to themselves. And we find ourselves in this strange situation of we're alone. You know, we've got the so-called left-wingers that are all pro-climate, yeah, fix the environment, but anti-nuclear, no, it's the death of the planet. And then we have the right wing that say they want nuclear, but they actually deny the evidence about climate change. But the psychology of both of those are the same. You know, it's just an inability to deal with the evidence, and it's confirmation bias. So, and for those who may have strong anti-nuclear feelings, I'm just gonna say today, that's okay. You know, I'm not here to absolutely change everyone's mind. I understand and accept that when ideas that are threatening to our worldview happen, it can feel very threatening. So I just, you know, that's okay. We're just here to discuss. Okay, and this is just some supporting data. I threw this in. Reasons why we should support nuclear. Well, it's for the climate. That's important. It's a big, it carries a big punch. The IPCC says we should. I mean, that's one of their conclusions. You know, that's that renewables, nuclear, carbon capture, storage, those are essential elements if we're going to make this thing work. It's the consensus position among leading scientists and scientific organizations. We've got the IPCC, we've got the International Energy Agency, we've got UNSCEAR, which is the United Nations Scientific Committee on Effects of Atomic Radiation. That group is an international scientist. They've been studying this for decades. They are the authorities on this. American Association for the Advancement of Science, that's the world's largest professional organization of scientists. they have all said we've got to have nuclear in our mix. So if a person is anti-nuclear, they have to really, really dig deep and kind of figure out, well, why am I opposing consensus scientific opinion? Nuclear is the only proven pathway to decarbonization. Many countries have tried, but France and Sweden, and actually Ontario, if you consider Ontario a country, it's not, but it's big enough, they have successfully decarbonized their electrical grid, and it's been done with nuclear and hydro. And all the other claims, countries like Germany and so forth, if you actually look at it, their carbon intensity, which is grams of CO2 per kilowatt hour, is much, much higher. It's not doing the job. So, and lastly, nuclear saves lives. And that's a James Hansen article. He did a study on that. And if you take out the nuclear that's already in place and replace it with fossil fuels, which is what would happen, we know the death rate caused by just particulate emission alone to the atmosphere. And so the nuclear we have in place globally now, they said it has saved us 1.8 million lives just from particulate pollution, not including climate effects.
Gary Wolves, James Hansen's essay. James Hansen's article.
Yes.
What's the national climate score? I might look it up.
I don't have the title here.
Oh, sorry.
You said that. Time for the, this is fun for geeks here.
Oh, God, it scares me.
Gotta have a laugh. Okay, now, this is going to help us to focus at the global level, because this is world energy flow. This is everything. You know, often when we talk about solar and wind, we have to remember, that's only electricity. And the other energy sectors, which are huge, are industrial process heat, you know, glass factories, transportation, tremendous. It's hard to do that with electricity. I mean, you have to get batteries for your cars, but you still can't do the ships and the trucks. Space heating, commercial, these are huge energy sectors. So this graph shows total global energy flow in petajoules. It's the unit of energy. It's a lot of energy. And what you want to look at in this graph, just to give perspective, is not the boxes, but this line here, and it's approximate to scale, so you have a sense for amounts. All right. So this much is coming out of biomass. And we have the other skinnier ones, and so you can see petroleum, you know, a lot of it goes for transportation, and then some goes up to industrial. And those are things that are really hard to do with solar and wind, really hard to do. But anyway, you can kind of see where wind and solar are. Nuclear is doing better. Geothermal, there's limits on hydro because a lot of it's already been done. We can expand it more, but there are a lot of environmental effects to hydro. And actually, it produces a lot of methane, which is a really potent greenhouse gas. So, you know, we can't expand hydro a lot. And all these other ones, biomass, not renewable. You can call it renewable, but it's not carbon neutral. Not in the time frame for climate mitigation. You know, we don't want to be cutting trees down. We want them to fix the carbon over this short time frame, mm-hmm. The next few decades.
Gary, what is rejected energy?
Rejected energy? Waste heat. Heat you can't capture and realistically use. And there's any process at all where you're trying to get energy, there's always going to be a fair amount of waste heat. Sometimes.
That can be captured.
Sometimes it can. Right. Right. Sometimes you can capture it, but there's always, that's part of entropy. I mean, there's, at a certain point, there's just low level heat energy that is just going to dissipate. But that's what that means. But I did a little math. And, you know, back to, for example, solar is 990 petajoules. As a fraction of the total, solar is 0.2% of global energy flow. And that's 2011. It's changed a tiny bit since then. Wind is 0.3%. Hydro is 2.4%. Nuclear is 5.2%. Geothermal is 0.5%. Biomass is 10%. But as I said, it's not carbon neutral. So that's not helping us.
But no, those are 2011 numbers, and the solar has really been skyrocketing the last few years.
But you're right, it has. But at the same time, so has global energy demand. And any of the increases in non-fossil energy supply are not even keeping up with the increase in global energy demand. So yes, you're right, there have been some impressive increases, but you know, this chart, this graph, kind of gives you a sense for, okay, this is really a big chunk. This is the heavy lift I was talking about.
Now, those reflect total use of energy, not electricity. So wind and solar have a higher proportion of electric.
Right, right. And I also compute from here that electricity usage globally is 39% of total primary energy. So in a way that's good because it's, you know, we can use wind and solar to help with that. Of course, nuclear does a great job too, but nuclear can also provide industrial process heat. And if you have, you know, excess fossil-free energy, you can start to do things like actually generate liquid fuels for our jet aircraft and our cars and trucks and ships. And so, but that's part of the challenge.
With nuclear?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's just a heat source, and you can actually, it's all processes we have today.
You mean it's like through electricity, through battery? Yeah. Or?
It's just, you just get a carbon source. Actually, you can take carbon out of the air or out of the water, and when you apply energy and industrial process, you can actually create fuels like ethanol, I mean, or ammonia. All those processes require energy. There's no reason to do it now because we're using fossil. But, you know, looking forward, if you have a plentiful non-fossil energy source, we can make liquid fuels.
Okay, is that in this book?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know what, generally area?
I don't.
I want to read it.
I don't. Mm-hmm. Okay, so then the other thing, and this comes up a lot, is the health effects. People are just terrified of radiation. And part of that is because that fear was inculcated as a cold war weapon. We wanted people to be afraid of radiation. Back in 1946, the linear no threshold hypothesis was kind of dreamed up as a basis for regulation. At that time, there was not any evidence to support it. There still is not. In fact, the circumstantial and epidemiological evidence we have now indicates that that hypothesis does not hold. And what linear no threshold says is that there's a linear risk of cancer all the way down to zero exposure. And it's just simply not true. And I mean, it's the dose rate that matters. And we see this from medical treatment. So in other words, you've got cancer.
go in for radiotherapy. They have a targeted beam, and these are truly massive amounts of radiation. And what they will do is they fractionate the treatment. They split it up every 2 days, once a week, you go in and you get another dose, and they keep doing it. If they gave you the entire dose in one sitting, you would be dead. But they know that the tissue recovers. They know exactly how much to give. That's not 100%, you know, every time, of course, but the medical community has done millions and millions of these treatments, actually for about 100 years. We know a lot about it. And to go to the other end of the scale, the hysterics we get from the general public about, you just say the word radiation or nuclear, and all reason just leaves. And the thing about radiation is we can detect down to the decay of a single atom. That's not the same thing as a biological effect. So there's a whole history behind this, and major scientific organizations are starting to come out and say, you know, these regulations really don't make any sense, because you've got the medical community and what they do, they know there's very little health effect, and then you have exposure limits that are just many orders of magnitude less than what has been shown to have any kind of cancer effect. So I don't want to say any more about that, but that's one issue that comes up a lot. And, you know, is it safe? There it is. Deaths per terawatt hour. I mean, you know, we can hear all the horrible things about Chernobyl and Fukushima, but where are the piles of bodies? It just,